Governor Gavin Newsom, brand new governor. He has to make a splash with his lefty friends. And so what he's going to do is vow to spend $260 million in California to pay for illegal immigrants' health care. He wants to raise the age threshold to receive government-funded coverage known as Medi-Cal, regardless of immigration status, from 19 to 26 for low-income people. It would cover about 138,000 people, according to the budget. Newsom argues his plan should be enacted because California residents are already paying for health care at the back end because of fees to emergency departments. But the analysis from the Legislative Analyst Office projected the plan will cost $330 million, plus it's going to draw more illegal immigrants to the state of California. Opposing this plan is Senator Bill Cassidy of the state of Louisiana. Senator Cassidy, thanks so much for joining the Ben Shapiro Show.
And thank you for having me. I understand this is the first week of your show, so it's an honor to be with you on that first week. Congratulations.
Oh, yeah, you're our very first guest, so congratulations to you, sir. So yeah, let's start off by asking, why exactly are you opposing Gavin Newsom's move here? Why is it imperative that states like California be stopped from spending what is largely California taxpayer money to pay for illegal immigrants' health care?
Two things. First, it is not going to be largely California's money. They're going to figure out a way to game the Medicaid system. Every state does it, but California does it really well, in which they pull down federal dollars, making it appear as if it's state dollars. Ultimately, there's going to be federal tax dollars involved. So my people in Louisiana are going to be paying for this largesse. Secondly, I just have a sympathy for that middle-class voter, that family in Los Angeles, maybe lives in Downey, who has done it right. They've paid their taxes, they're working hard, they're paying a lot for employer-sponsored health insurance, and here somebody moves to our country illegally in order to get free health care and other benefits, having never paid a dime of taxes, and now gets to access something for free, which the taxpayer in Downey is paying for through their taxes, and by the way, they don't get it for free. I just got a sympathy for that family. This is not about immigration. It's about math.
I mean, Senator, frankly, as a longtime Californian, you know, I've lived my entire life in California, there's no question that the state has shifted its politics largely in reaction to policies like this that are meant to pander to particular constituent bodies in order to shift votes to the Democratic Party.
I don't live in California. I lived in California when I did my medical residency. And so lived in East L.A., lived in places you would know, Manhattan Beach, et cetera, and Pasadena. And when you live there, when you work in those hospitals, you realize that people would fly into California with heart problems to get free care at L.A. County Hospital, and then when they were through, they would fly home to their country. I saw that happen. Now, this is not just the episodic, okay, you're having heart chest pain, so we're going to do your surgery for your heart. No, this is giving insurance. And this is giving insurance so that people can move and have long-term chronic conditions, which they could have taken care for in their home country, but they'd rather not pay the money. So they move to the U.S. and they get it for free, paid for by that taxpayer in San Fernando Valley. It's just not fair.
Well, Senator Cassidy, I want to ask you now more broadly about the situation with the government shutdown. Right now, it seems like we're at an impasse between President Trump, Senator Schumer, Nancy Pelosi. What's the latest that you're hearing? Do you think that we are headed toward the president declaring a national emergency and then trying to activate the military to build the wall?
I think the president is keeping that on the table. He looks at the drugs flowing across our southern border, the fentanyl that's coming across, that's killing 48,000 Americans per year, more than we lost in Vietnam, but it's in 1 year that this occurs. And he wants to do something to stem that tide. Every state's a border state. California in particular, but I promise you, in Louisiana, people are dying from fentanyl overdoses. He wants to stem that tide. Pelosi and Schumer, beyond saying there's a better way, never actually give that better way. And so if the president decides to declare it, I'm sure that'll be the basis upon which he does so.
Well, Senator, I mean, do you think that he has the legal basis to declare it? So as a constitutional conservative, I'm really loathe to grant more power to the executive branch, particularly since so much power was arrogated to President Obama. My feeling is that if the president wants to hold the Democrats' feet to the fire, he should just continue holding the Democrats' feet to the fire, make them defend why they want to keep hundreds of thousands of workers away from their jobs just to avoid paying $5.7 billion to Border Patrol. The declaration of a national emergency seems like, to me, a constitutional conservative cop-out. First of all, I don't think it withholds legal scrutiny. But secondly, even if you think it's legal, is it going to work? I mean, are the courts going to allow it to go forward, or is it just a way of kicking the can down the road some more?
You got a lot in there, so let me unpack it. Speaking to the people, I'm a doctor, obviously. So speaking to the people that follow the law, they do think that courts would invalidate it. So I think you're right there. Secondly, I share your concern. It would be a transfer of power from the legislative to the executive, and I don't particularly agree with it. In fact, I don't agree with that. But what I can say, there are pots of money that are under the control of the executive that the president would not have to invoke executive power. Rather, the way law is currently constructed, the president has jurisdiction over those dollars. So I think he could use that to begin the wall. By the way, it's going to be an expensive proposition. So it's not as if this appropriation is the last appropriation. It is the beginning of appropriations. And so those dollars, for example, by the way, let me just speak in particular. Under a proposal I've made, there's about $100 billion, that's with a B, $100 billion, that cartels transfer from the United States to Mexico and other Latin American countries related to the drug trade. That's $100 billion. The federal government seizes about $6 billion of that. That money is up to the Department of Justice to use for law enforcement. If we could increase that $6 billion even more, then one, you put a crimp in the business plan of the cartels, but two, it's the cartels paying for the wall. It's not the American people paying for it. That's a bill I put up. It makes sense, and I would like the Mexican cartels to be paying for this because they would contribute to stopping the drugs flowing in, and that would be a beautiful irony.
I mean, that seems like it makes perfect sense to me. Who exactly is the holdup there? I mean, the Republicans still control the Senate. Why hasn't that been brought to the floor?
I don't think the holdup on that is not going to pass the House, but the holdup on that is that you've got to get the executive on board to do it because it's the executive's money to play with. And so the president actually has control over that right now. There's other pots of money similar to that, which the either self-generated by the executive branch or otherwise the executive has control over without a legislative appropriation. So we stay within the Constitution, but the president has the ability to allocate some resources.
So how do you think all of this ends, Senator? I mean, it feels like it's now kind of devolved into theater on both sides. You've got Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer standing there looking idiotic next to each other, proclaiming that a wall is not in fact a moral thing, that a wall is inherently bad. You've got President Trump down at the border talking about walls and wheels. How does this thing come to an end? And when it does end, do you think that there actually is some progress on the wall? Or basically, does everybody go home, tell their base that they won, and we move on with our lives?
I think there has to be progress on the wall. Ben, I know, but I suspect you do too, people who have died from fentanyl overdoses. That is an American imperative to address this issue. And when the president speaks of the heart and soul of the issue, I think Democrats have to answer, how are we going to stop that flow of drugs? There's many issues. There's not one answer. But one answer has to be increased border security. And we have evidence that in certain areas, walls work. Walls work. Not across the entire border, but you take an urban center, San Diego, walls work. It forces people to go through checkpoints, and at that checkpoint, you have a greater ability to discover those drugs. I think as that case is made more and more, even Democratic base will be asking, what are we doing to stem this flow of fentanyl from Mexico? And hopefully that imperative, as I said earlier, drives Democrats to do something to help do so.
Well, Senator Bill Cassidy of Louisiana, thank you so much for joining us. I really appreciate it, and thanks for continuing to fight in favor of legal immigration, against illegal immigration, and in favor of a constitutional solution to some of these questions while keeping pressure on the Democrats who refuse to apparently engage in any sort of negotiations. Really appreciate your time.
Thanks, Ben.